It is July 12th. Happy summer. It's Thursday night, 8 o'clock in Winchester. And we are live on the radio, live on tape. Himself is here, Ron Cox. Hello.
Hey, is this like a radio show and a TV show?
That's the whole point. The whole point is Anthony's a very busy man, but thank God he helped us. He's a great guy. He helped
now
us get this
Anthony's
together.
Now, here, what does he do?
He works with Dave Gauthier.
Now, what's his position?
I don't know. You have to ask Anthony.
But you should know this.
I don't know anything. I'm just a host.
Well, look, he's helping you out. You gotta.
He's great, but the thing is that we have a show, and visual radio is set up so I don't need a staff.
Oh, okay.
It's radio for your TV.
Oh, I get it.
Okay.
So, but we're going to talk a lot, right? So what are we talking about?
We're talking about live on tape first.
Okay.
You're my guest. You had me on. I was on a show called
normally
Live
a
on
host.
Tape.
Just tell your audience that. I'm normally a host. This is
a month and a day ago, on June 11th, today's July 12th, he had me on his show. I can't believe it's been a month.
A whole month has gone by. Now I'm on your show.
Yeah, but we tables have turned that.
Literally.
But I thought we were going to talk a lot about Access, which we'll do tonight.
Yeah, I think we should talk Access. But I won an award after 22 years.
Well, that's what I want to say. Live on tape. My first question to you is, how long have you been doing live on tape?
22 years. 1990.
22 years.
Yeah.
So, it's older than visual radio by 5 years.
That's
but I was on TV in 79 and proved it on
yes,
this show.
That's right.
So, we both
go way back. You go way back. No doubt about it.
And you are a cartoonist.
Yes. That's primarily, I actually started doing the cartoons and art and social work. Then I got into community media kind of on the side.
When you did the first live on tape, what station?
It was Malden. I was one of the first volunteer members in the organization. I think my number is like 8 or something. Yeah.
This is good.
So I started out as a volunteer saying, hey, I want to get involved. When I found out a place existed like that, I said, well, gee, I was doing stuff at BFVF, which is...
Oh, you were?
Oh, yeah.
Boston Film and Video Foundation.
I'm one of the founders of BFVF.
You are?
Yes, I am.
I had no idea.
One of the 12.
Over there on Boston Street.
It was on Boston Street, and then before that, it was on over in Brighton Ave.
So you were doing cartoons, and then you helped found Boston Film and Video.
Yeah, because I was doing film. I was doing animation.
What year?
Oh, this is 1974, 75.
So you're earlier than me when it comes to this stuff. Wow.
Well, yeah, but it wasn't really community media then. It was really...
doing film.
Doing film, and I went to school, for the arts. And then what had happened, actually, how BFA founded was a group of people around, we would gather together because we borrowed each other's equipment.
Okay.
So Susan Wall one day said, we get a grant, and if we organize, we can get equipment donated to us. And we said, well, that's a great idea.
It's a wonderful idea.
And that's exactly what happened. We, John Rubin, Susan Wall, Steve, so many great names at the time, Stuart Fordyce. Michelle Schofield was our first director that we hired. And she's now runs, she's the one of the vice presidents of Mass College of Art. Yeah, she was great.
This is a wonderful place.
It was a wonderful place. So that's what happened.
No, that is a wonderful place too. Mass College.
Oh, Mass College. That's right.
Both.
I'm an alumni of that. And actually, I saw myself just recently because a good friend passed away, Bob Raymond, who was another BFFer. He was the very first tech guy we had.
Now, I usually have to worry about my guests and their mics, but you just put yours on, right? You're so good. See, he's a professional. Usually my guests don't know that about.
Well, I asked if it was on. It is on, right?
Oh, yeah. Say something.
Yeah, how you doing?
Yeah, see?
Are we live? Is this like a live
this
show?
This is live, yeah, we're live. Wow. And we're on Verizon contiguous channels. I guess Woburn gets us.
Yeah.
Which is a whole other thing.
You're seeing in Malden, right? You're on MATV, right?
Oh, yeah. No, visual radio's on MATV, but not live.
Right, okay. But yeah, because it's like Malden. Live and tape. We do live and tape live once a month. And the show's evolved. And one great thing about live and tape, and I did bring in my entry. I don't know if you can show clips, but...
No, because I'd have to go in there and...
Right. Do you do a post?
No. Oh. We're live on the air. How can I do a post?
Oh, because we're live right now here. Yeah, we couldn't.
But that's
for
it's fun.
Stations.
But, yeah, for...
I thought you told me to bring stuff to show, no?
No, I didn't say that.
Oh, I think
I don't have a crew. Oh. But now, see, I'm exposing you to visual radio, which is good.
I know. It's good to do that.
Yesterday there was a Comcast party for Open Voice. Now, do you know about Open Voice?
Yes, and it was also one at my house, my apartment building, too. It's
really?
Tonight. It's actually tonight.
In your apartment
my
building?
My apartment building.
So these are very nice people. It's Think Argus. Do you know who they are?
No.
Think Argus is a company. Now, Comcast is investing a lot in this Open Voice.
Right.
There were 5 cities around the country, Peterborough, New Hampshire,
mm-hmm.
Kalia, whatever, Hialeah.
Do you know exactly what it is? Yeah. I missed the party because I came to this one.
Well.
When does the party start, Joe?
Well, the party's yesterday was 3:30 to 5:30. What they were basically doing was signing newbies up.
Yeah.
So you and I don't have to be there.
Right.
Because just they have a little coffee and fruits.
And I think they tempt you because they give something away free.
Well, they're giving food away.
No, this one's also giving away a raffle.
Oh, well, Comcast is now putting stuff on the internet. So they have Made in Medford.com. But Open Voices in Malden?
Well, I don't know. I don't think it is.
Oh, then it's a separate thing you're talking about.
I think
about,
this is a separate thing. Comcast is running in apartment buildings.
Oh, okay.
Just to get people involved and get...
That's not Open Voice.
Okay.
Open Voice is happening in 6 cities around the country, right? I didn't think Malden was one of them.
Yeah, because Medford would be the localist one, right?
Right. Now, they bought...
I think Malden should have gotten it, by the way, but...
Well, no. Because Malden has a great access station. That's the whole point.
Oh, that's I see what you're saying.
Where access doesn't really... where it needs some help.
Right.
They are putting these Open Voice things in because they bought Universal.
Yeah, but what? Tell me what an Open Voice is.
Let me tell you first. Comcast bought Universal NBC.
Yeah, for content.
Right. And so the FCC made them start this Open Voice. It's an FCC kind of thing. They're fulfilling a requirement.
To like balance out that they get all this content?
Yeah, so, well, that to give a voice to the local community. Okay. So now...
But isn't that what public access is supposed to be?
Yeah, well... How come my show is only on contiguous channels in Medford?
I don't know.
There you go.
Why is this show not seen by everybody?
Because that's why there's Open Voice now in Medford. Do you get it?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, now you understand.
But let's see what they do with it. I mean, have they done anything with it?
Well, here's the fear. The fear, people, is that this is a project to stop access. So that once you put access on demand channels and on the internet, you don't have to have a channel for access.
Right.
So it might be Comcast's way of creating the end of access.
And as we all know, they'd rather not to do it because, you know, to them it's money going down the drain.
But it's not their money because it's a surcharge.
Well, that's right. I mean, I'm sure your audience understands.
They don't.
Why.
You have to explain it all the time.
Well, they'll explain it. I mean, public access is actually part of a cable act back in the 70s that when cable providers go into a community, the community has a right to negotiate with that cable company for the use of the public rights of way and the underground conduits that make it possible for them to hook up to the houses and make millions of dollars. So they have to give something back. That's the idea of giving back to the community. The problem is, though, every community doesn't necessarily negotiate a good contract. In Massachusetts, we're lucky because it's very educated, a lot of communities, and we got great lawyers, and it's a great movement in terms of mass access and organizations that really understand how to get the best deal. But not everyone does get a good deal.
Malden has one of the best access centers around. And people ask me.
In 2008, we got Northeast Best Outstanding Access Center.
Now, people ask me, what's a good access center? And I say Malden. Not because you're my friend.
No, I would
say
it
too. But you do a good job.
Right. Thank you. It's not me. That's what I'm saying.
You're a core part of it.
Right.
You have a great team.
It's almost like I let this team do what they do best, and that is connect to the community. A good access center has to connect to the community so the community is using it. It's a resource. And if it's not being used, there's a problem with outreach, obviously, and obviously communication. You know, that's because we're very active. The show's going on right now, you know, obviously here too, but in Malden. And it's we have two studios, a Studio A and a Studio B. Studio B is like a hot set, similar to what you got going here. Things can be automatic.
Well, I create a hot set, you know, environment.
Yeah, very hot. But you don't change the shot, do you? I mean, it's just one
no.
shot.
Yeah, it's a radio for your TV.
Right.
You can turn off the video and you can still hear a good show.
Right.
Because this would be good on BUR.
I would hope so, yeah.
Yeah,
doing radio.
I'll tell you how excited I am about access still after all these years. Last week I had Jimmy Church on.
Yeah.
Now, you know I was friends with Bobby Hebb who wrote Sonny.
Yeah.
Very close friend of mine. And so Jimmy Church was telling me about Bobby Hebb being in his band when Bobby got out of the Navy.
Does the audience know the band you're talking about?
Well, Bobby Hebb, Sonny. My audience should know that Sonny, Bobby Hebb.
Right.
And Jimmy Church is from Nashville, so he phoned in from Nashville. But he told me that Bobby sent him up to New York and they worked with Mickey Baker and did a song called I Wish that Bobby wrote. Now, even Bobby's manager didn't know about this song, I Wish. I found it on the internet last night.
Right.
And now, Visual Radio has discovered a rare Jimi Hendrix tape with Little Richard. You know Little Walter's time machine?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Little Walter was on the show, pulled out a Jimi Hendrix Little Richard tape. We discovered it. Last week, we discovered I Wish by Bobby Hebb. So I have so much fun investigating media.
Right. Well, in the old days, that you kind of were into that world with Boston Music Sound. And
With the records I was making and articles I wrote.
Yeah, and exactly. You helped promote that early, you know, rock. What would you call it? You know, that
We had the rock and roll scene. We had an independent rock and roll scene.
And they called you the Count. I remember that.
Yeah.
You know,
I'm the artist formerly known as the Count.
John Butcher, who was now back. He went out to California. Now he's back. He played the national anthem at Fenway Park. Isn't that cool? Just like Jimi Hendrix did. And he's a lot like him in a way.
Well, did you see the Showtime movie Hendrix?
No.
There's a Showtime movie called Hendrix. Guess who the guitarist is?
Was it him doing it?
It's Butcher playing all the Hendrix parts. He's on Star Trek: The Next Generation. He is on that movie. What's that movie about? Deadwood.
Yes. Oh yeah, he was in that.
And did you see? Yeah, did you see that he was the blacksmith?
I have all the clips of him making the movie. He had a blast. Those guns are realistic. I mean, they're really real.
But he's the soundtrack guy.
Yeah, exactly. But he's also in it.
Yeah, they decided to put the soundtrack guy in it. He was a black blacksmith.
Yeah.
In the Old West, you never see black men in the Old West movies. It's great. Yeah. So, but he did Star Trek Next Generation, too.
And
now
he's with Charlie Farron, and that's a great combination. Exactly.
So, and Robin Farron.
They call themselves, what do they call themselves?
They're called FBI.
FBI, right.
Farron Butcher, Inc. Yeah, I get this email. Charlie and John are together, but don't tell anyone. It's a big secret. And it's like, well,
FBI.
I love them, but the whole world doesn't know them yet. Charlie was the lead singer, Joe Perry Project.
Right.
And Butcher had a bunch of albums out on Polydor.
I did lighting for Johanna Wild. That's
did
how,
you?
I, how I knew him. So I was also doing lighting. It's another thing. When you graduate from college, you think, okay, I'm ready to be a great filmmaker, because that didn't happen. I don't get that. But anyway,
Anthony did great lighting for us tonight.
Yeah, very nice.
Because you can tell the proof of the pudding is right there on the monitor.
Right. Well, there it is, too, yeah.
See, this is fun. We've had 13 minutes, 12 and a half minutes already, and all we do is talk media.
Yeah, so that's how you do it. So you talk it, and the thing is you don't have to worry about the cameras, because it's one shot. Hey, how you doing?
It's radio. It's just my radio show.
For those people listening on radio.
Who?
So where's your mic? You're down there?
I put it on the desk, because I'm loud.
Really?
After 33 years, I kind of know where my voice goes. It goes there.
All right.
It's
probably got a boosted way up. So we want to talk about...
I wore my shorts, but I can't see them like that.
Access?
Let's talk about your award. So all these 22 years, you finally won an award.
And I entered at 12 times. I really did. I entered 12. I came second one year, 2005. I came second. But it's not the same. I wanted first. It's best in the nation, which is pretty cool.
And congratulations to you.
And the other thing is the program I do, I also work with kids and do a
Able
project.
Able Vision?
No, they won too, by the way. Able Vision, great.
They deserve to.
Oh, Project Triangle does a great job with these, it's funny, now they say men with adults with abilities instead of disabilities, because, they do have disabilities, but it's what they do, it's great. They produce, they shoot, they act, they're in their talent, they're everything about that show is done by the people you see on the camera.
Adults with abilities.
That's right. So they won Access with Ability category. And that's, I think, their fourth or fifth time, too. But I was going to say, so the Kids Video Workshop is a program that I actually designed in Salem. For those who know David Gautier, he used to be in Salem. Actually, David's very familiar with the Kids Video Club. That's where I kind of made it happen.
Okay, so let's backtrack a little. You started in Malden as a volunteer.
Yes.
Did you join the staff at some point?
Actually, this is a good story. I used to work at the YWCA with kids, and I would bring them down to MATV to use the equipment, make TV shows, right? That's why I was there. So the executive director said, Ron, you're doing such a great job with kids. We'd like to pay you to teach the kids. I said, well, I'm already being paid by the Y. He said, no, on the side, or maybe you should think about doing this for a living. So I did start teaching kids video for money, and what a great concept. And then she said, well, there's a position opening up in Salem. Why don't you go for it?
So what was your position in Malden? You were just called a coordinator?
I was a video teacher.
Video teacher?
Yeah.
Oh, so I didn't realize that. So then you went up to Salem.
Well, it wasn't that easy. I was down to two people for the finals. It was me and a woman named Ruth Durkee, who became Ruth Kennedy, who's a wonderful person. And it was came down to two of us. So when I went to meet Bob Mio, who was executive director, to get hired, I took one look. He introduced us both. So his is Ron, he's second two, and you're tied. I mean, this interview is going to decide. And I took one look at her, and I met her. I said, nice to meet you. And she's absolutely beautiful. And I say, there's no way that they're going to hire me over her. So I said to her, so where are you working now? And she said, oh, a place called Wakefield Community Access Television, WCAT. And I said, well, good luck. That night, I called WCAT. I said, hey, I hear you got an opening.
Oh, right.
And Robert Haig, who was running it at the time, said, what are you talking about? I said, no, oh, okay. Well, maybe not now, but I got a feeling. Just give me a call. It's Ron Cox. I'm interested in the position. And I hung up. Well,
you gave him your number.
I gave him the number. So I think maybe 2 weeks later, Ruth gives her notice. Robert calls me immediately. He goes, all right, how the hell did you know? And who the hell are you? I want to meet you. And that's how I got the job.
So you hadn't known Robert before that?
No. Only by the phone. Only
and
by
what
the
year was like, 95?
This is 94.
Okay, because 1988, the late Gene Sylvester and I had an office building in Wakefield. And under our office...
Really?
We had an office in a building.
Right.
Under our office...
I bet you knew the building.
Robert Haig, 27 Water Street.
Oh, that's right. That's where it was. Oh, my God.
Because Crystal...
Because he worked for Comcast at the time. Well, it wasn't called Comcast.
I was upstairs with Gene Sylvester, who was the editor of the Daily...
Night, because it was the newspaper.
Daily Times and whatever. And so, Gene, my friend, and I had an office upstairs...
So you're above Water Street, oh my gosh.
We were Crystal Communications with our CCI report, the Crystal Communications report. And I was managing Jimmy Miller from the Rolling Stones, and you're right there.
Wow.
So I go downstairs with a guest, Gary Santarella, a guy I produced. And Bob Haig had that folk show.
That's right. It's called Acoustic Cafe.
So he put Gary Santarella on for me, and it was the first time I ever ran a camera in 1988, summer of 88, down at Wakefield Cable.
And so Time Warner, it was a Time Warner Amex building then.
So you went over to Wakefield.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. I got the job, and Ruth only lasted 1 year.
Huh?
She was gone in a year. She got pregnant.
Oh.
So Bob calls me back. He says, oh, I wish we hired you. Why don't you come back?
Because you won't get pregnant.
Why don't you come to Salem?
You won't get pregnant.
Well, I could still have a child with someone else. But he said, come to Salem. We got your job for you. I said, no, I thought we took the job away in Wakefield. How can I do that?
And so, what were you in Wakefield?
I was the program director.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I just put on the program. You know, the worst thing about that job...
Oh, right, I saw you and Bob working together.
Oh, yeah, it was really just a two-person operation.
At the high school. You moved from Water Street over to a high school.
It was, I think, a junior high at the time, or elementary school.
I remember going over and visiting you guys.
It was on Converse Street. That's where we...
So that's probably where I first met you.
Oh, here's another funny story. So that's exactly where the studio is. WCAT is in an old elementary school building. We had the first floor, and upstairs was storage.
This is Access history. Listen up.
It really is. It's an incredible story because it was a great building that they had, and a great studio, and it was well thought out. But all of it was not used. It was just storage, and we used for props. And of course, during Halloween, we made it a haunted studio. It was great for that. But eventually, I wrote a grant for a thing called the Senior Television Workshop, and I got a grant to work with the seniors. Well, it was so good. This woman, Marion Whiting, loved the building so much. And then I left. I went to Salem, by the way. I said, Salem finally, after 3 years, made an offer I couldn't refuse. So I did go to Salem.
And what was the position there?
There I was a director of outreach and production.
Okay.
It was a great job. It was.
And you sponsored Visual Radio, I recall.
I think so.
I know so.
That's right, Salem.
Thank you.
And that's where I met David Gautier, who was great. We had the same office for the longest time, for 6 years.
So you and David shared an office?
Shared an office, yeah.
Wow.
It was a fun time. He listened to a lot of sports radio. Yeah, so Dave knows everything about sports.
And so, you know, Dave, here at WinCAM, they let us in on the interviews, and Dave was interviewed, and now he's ED here.
It is kind of like that. So I went from... I got the job in Wakefield, then I went to Salem. And then what ended up happening, the executive director left. just kind of...
In Wakefield?
In Salem. So they made me acting director.
Okay.
But they didn't end up picking me after 9 months, which I found very inconvenient. You know, not after 9 months, you think...
And were you living in Malden?
I was living in Gloucester then.
Oh, so that was...
So I was commuting. It was a great commute. I took the train.
Salem to... Yeah.
Gloucester to Salem.
Not bad.
It was great.
Nice.
So, but because they didn't hire me as ED, they kind of went to a different direction. So I got to move on. Then the Wakefield position became open. Robert moved to Lowell at LLC.
Right.
So then his job became open. I went for his job.
Which they knew me. LTC.
Is it LTC?
Lowell Television.
Yeah, that's LTC, LTC, right. And telecommunications company or something like that. So then I became back, they hired me back at WCAT as the ED. So what was good about that is I got ED experience, because I was only acting ED, and then I got to be a real ED. And
I moved visual radio over to Wakefield to be with Ron.
Really?
And I brought you a lot of acts.
And then I was there for 3 years, and then the Malden position came open, and I'm thinking, oh my God, ED, it's my hometown, I've been there, I was on the board, and so I'm for the job. And I got it. That's history.
2 nights ago, I went over to Wakefield because they allow other people to be members. And I'm a member at Winthrop, Cambridge.
Yeah, how do you do that, Joe? I mean,
there are certain stations that let you be a member.
Really?
And it's...
Because in our place, you have to work there or go to school there or live there.
Yeah, but in certain cities and towns, they allow you to.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, so Winthrop, I'm a member. Cambridge, I'm a member. Okay, so Wakefield, I went over. The tech didn't know me. There's a new techie there. There's been a bit of a revolving door.
Yes, yes.
So I said, okay.
But Tom's still there, I think, right?
Yeah, Tom and David. So I said, you know, I want to join. So I just wrote out the check and left some DVDs. And I haven't talked to them since because I've been so busy all week.
Yeah.
But I think I'm a member of Wakefield again.
Well, I know they changed program directors. It's funny, when I worked there...
They have a woman now.
When I worked there, Sean Downs was there, and...
How's he doing, do you know?
He's doing great. He had a stroke, that's why you asked.
Young guy.
But his story is a lot like Gretzky, or is that his name? Bruschi.
Teddy Bruschi,
where he really came back, not completely as much as Ted did, but now he works at Project Triangle, which... by the way, got the award for best...
Does he work with you?
He works with Ablevision. Not me, he works with Ablevision.
But he comes over to Malden.
Yeah, yeah.
So you see Sean?
I see Sean, yeah.
Tell him I said hello.
I will.
He's a great
guy.
Well,
actually, I was just talking to him recently, I was talking to Elisa. I congratulate her. I wanted to see if she's going to Chicago to get the award, because it's going to be Chicago. So I'm going out to Chicago to pick up 4 awards. So I'm happy.
Good for
that.
You. Visual Radio's done 600 shows. One would think that an organization would go out of its way to go explore people that do 600 shows. Like Reeling. Has Reeling ever won?
Yeah, but they don't enter. You know, you got to enter the
win. But I mean, my whole point is, how can you be the best in the country if there are all these shows and it's only the people that enter? And I'm no.
But it's got to be.
You deserve it.
You have to enter it.
Well, I entered it through here, but my feeling is, if you're going to make something the best in the country, go out and seek. You know, really.
Yeah, I don't think it works that way. You got to promote your show. You got to push it and promote it. And
I know.
And that's what I'm saying. I think I wore down the judges, and that's how I won.
But they have different judges at different stations.
They do. In fact, the judging is supposed to be very democratic. It's supposed to be done by other access centers across the country. And I would hope that who judged. What's interesting is, you know, one video that I thought was going to win. About it was a promo for Access. It's called Voices of Democracy. It was great, but it didn't win. And I was like,
"That's my point. That's my point." Now, Live on Tape deserves it because you've been involved for 22 years.
Yeah. And I do think it was a great entry. I was very confident of it.
And that's my point. If someone's been doing it, Reeling, they should go out of their way to find Reeling. Now, I believe Reeling follows this show.
On Malden or
right
other
here.
Places?
In Winchester. I think we have your Reeling show.
Yeah.
And they've been doing a lot.
Well,
I
could be live on tape here. So, who could sponsor it? Do you have to get sponsored?
I could sponsor it.
Okay.
Or Dave Gothier.
Now they're a national. That's right. David knows the show.
And you know who the programming guy is? That's what Anthony's our programmer.
Oh, okay.
I've got Bluesheimer's.
Hope you get the program on.
You know, I got Bluesheimer's. So, It's hard for me to remember. But we have a public domain movie show on Friday nights. So at like 10 of, Frank Delastrito is going to call in from Alaska.
Really? Are you getting a phone call coming in?
Yeah.
Because you did it on my show. I've never done it on my show. You were the first time I ever did it. Oh, really?
Okay. So Delastrito will call in. He's he's one of Bela Lugosi's biographers.
Really?
Yeah, he's a great guy. You did a great job because you had the phone come right in over all the speakers. It was great.
Yeah, yeah.
But wasn't that fun?
Oh, it was great. First of all, I was a little reluctant to do it, I must say, you know, to talk to a band member who I didn't really know. But it worked out great. And the funny thing is, the reason it wasn't working, he had the wrong number. We gave him the wrong number. Well, I gave him the wrong number. Because we have two talk shows, one downstairs, one upstairs. They're different phone numbers, so.
They loved it. They loved being on it. They appreciated it.
Oh, good. Okay.
And, you know, it's fun for a band from Australia to know, hey, people in Malden know we exist.
I know. He said, you had trouble with money to get out here. And I said, we'll chip in for you.
You know, this is our little forum. And Wakefield, I just rejoined. So they went from that other school. Now,
is this a phone call?
This is a local legend. Dave Goth, you should know who this is. Hello.
Hey, how's it going?
Good, who's this?
This is Duke. How you doing?
I thought it was John Byers. But
who
since it's not...
why don't you find out who it was? Maybe
because they're not supposed to call this line because we don't give the line out.
Well, how do you know?
Huh?
You must have. Was it the wrong number?
No, I have a good idea who it might have been.
Really?
Yeah, sure. I'm not going to say it on the air.
Okay.
You know.
So you don't have a delay with that?
No, I have stalkers.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, you're lucky. I don't have any stalkers.
No.
No stalkers.
Well, that's because you go off to places where horses run wild and
free. Oh, what a great time that was. Vieques. I forgot how you say it. Vieques. It's off of Puerto Rico. And it was absolutely beautiful. And the funny thing happened with that trip, I'm down in this island.
Do you have to take a boat or do you fly right to the island?
You can take a boat or fly. It's better to fly because they can't always guarantee that the boat's going to be there on time. Hey, it's laid back kind of land.
How far is it from Puerto Rico itself?
I think about 6 miles.
That's not far.
Not far at all. I mean,
you can almost
see it.
Swim it.
You could
take two sharks.
Yeah, right. Ride them.
Yeah.
But wasn't that great photo of that guy who's kayaking and looks behind him and, what? At the shack? That was great. But this island is and it's beautiful and it's over like just so you fly this plane over to the island and it doesn't really even go that high. It's like if it goes off in the sky, you feel like hey, we could just plop in the ground and everything would be fine. But it makes it over and then. You get to this little island. What's great about it, it's undeveloped because the Navy used to own it. The Navy used to like blow it up all the time.
They used to blow up the island.
Well, yeah, the ammunition.
And the little
half the island was used for ammunition. The other half was used to be blown up. So the area that was being blown up is now a conservation land. You know, number one is they don't want you going in there because you know you don't want to step on stuff. But slowly they're cleaning it up. And once they clean it up, that land goes back to being beautiful and
when you say step on stuff like landmines?
Yeah, like blown up shells.
So the poor horses landmines. Might...
Yeah, well, it's happened. A few horses have blown up.
Oh.
But the horses don't really go there because they learn. You know, where did Billy go? Oh, he blew up yesterday. We don't want to go over there. They learn. But they're everywhere else, though. They're down the beaches. They roam around. It's beautiful.
The horses just roam around wild.
So here I'm on this island. And I'm in this town called Esperanza. I was trying to get a postcard. And all of a sudden, this guy comes up to me, takes my shoulder, turns me around, and it's the newly elected mayor of Malden, Gary Christensen.
Down there.
I go, what? What? Gary Christensen? What are you doing here? And he's laughing.
Horseback riding.
He was like laughing like a little kid. I gotcha. And I went, you sure did it. You know, what are you doing? You're still running for election?
You do have a stalker.
Yeah, Gary Christensen. So I said to him, Gary, what are you doing here? You don't need the Puerto Rican vote. You already won. But it was great. We were there for the next day. We just spent a day with himself and a couple. He came with 3 friends. And it was great. We had a great time.
Now, is Puerto Rico a territory? That,
it's what?
Are they a territory?
Yes, of the United States. You don't need a passport.
Would the island be a territory, too?
Right, you don't need an
island. So it's all Puerto Rico.
It's all right. So when we had a place, it was like a villa. We rented a villa. So we had a kitchen. So we go shopping, and of course everyone's speaking Spanish, but they do understand, you know, the money.
No habla español.
Yeah. So, but it was great. We had a great time. It's a great beaches are beautiful. They're all skull beaches, so they're all practically deserted, a lot of them, and it was great. But meeting the mayor there, the mayor-elect, was bizarre.
Of Malden. I mean, that's really strange. Of all the mayors in the country.
Right.
The Malden mayor.
Of course, my friend Peggy, when I was there, she says, you know, no work, I don't want you working. And then, like, the next to last day, I meet the mayor. So I said, Gary, let's take a walk. I got to show you this cave. And, of course, we talk shop.
Of course.
But in a cave. And a beautiful paradise. I thought, is this wild or
what? Well, is that like the Cone of Silence and Get Smart, or was it more like the Bat Cave?
Yeah, it's more like the Bat Cave. It's just really, it's pretty cool.
I'm going to see The Dark Knight Rises on Tuesday.
Yeah, I've heard good things
Critics
about
screening.
It. Yeah. Batman Rises, right?
The Dark Knight Rises.
The Dark Knight Rises, right. Yeah. Ooh, who's this?
This is my roommate. Do you want to talk to the...
Oh, so while he's talking, I guess I have to talk.
You're live on TV. Can we help you?
Yeah, it's kind of like live on tape. It's visual radio.
Can I call you in 30 minutes? All right, call you in 30 minutes.
So in your show, you know, most shows, they say, turn off your cell phones. You're
but that's my roommate, and he's lived with me as long as I've had a TV show. So
oh, really?
One would think, live with me for 16 years, and I've done a show for 15 years,
don't call during the show.
You know the show is on Thursday Night Live. But hey, it's a dinner invitation.
Oh, well, yeah, I got to turn that
And
down.
He interrupted the show so he can pay.
No, that'd be good.
There you go. See? Yeah. So,
so show him the tape.
No, I mean, you know, it's... We have fun. It's laid back. Why?
Yeah, well, I like that part about it. You know, it'd be good if one of your crew could give me a glass of water.
I'll get you a glass of water if you want to talk. You want to talk about Access TV? And tell us about Live on Tape and your award and what you're going to do in Chicago.
All right. Well, here, let me tell you about
Did you win awards last year when you went to Arizona?
Yes.
How many?
Two.
All right, so you went to Arizona.
Yeah, two songs.
You can tell them about what happened. I'll get you a glass of water.
Well, I'll tell you a funny story. I went there with my assistant director, Andrew Rose, and this place is in Tucson, and Arizona, and it's a resort. So we're taking a walk, the grounds, and we looked in the distance, and there was a shower. I mean, just like in this little spot of cloud, and it's moving towards us. So we said, you know, Andrew, we probably should start walking back, because there's a shower coming. And you can really see it. It's like this little desert shower heading towards us. So needless to say, we're running, and it caught up with us, and we're getting wet. And I say to Ann, she goes, oh no, we're getting wet. And I said, but Ann, it's a dry rain. That's the big thing out there. Everything's dry. Oh, thank you.
See, you didn't need me to talk.
Yeah, I know.
I need a glass now. Can you keep talking?
Yeah, I can.
You haven't done television.
I know. It's like, I have done television. What do you mean? Have I done it?
No, I'm having fun with you.
It's my first time on visual radio.
I've known Ron for a long time, since the Wakefield days. I must have met you at the Wakefield school. That's where we must have met.
Yeah, that probably is.
I
had a great time. You know, what's great about Wakefield, and actually learned a lot from Robert Haig. He was a very good teacher of things I've learned, and I'm very grateful for that. And a lot of it had to do with the outreach part and dealing with community, and... I'll never forget, you know Adam Dusenberry.
He
hit his crap.
It's in Belmont now.
Well, Adam, and when I first got the job, Robert said, oh, you want to go down and shoot the homecoming, the annual homecoming fair. He said, this is a great chance to meet the community, get the people, and get out there. I said, oh, great, yeah, that sounds great. I'll get a camera person, right? He goes, oh, yeah, I'll get you one. And he's a great guy. So we show up the day of the event, and my cameraman shows up, and he's 12 years old. I said, where's the camera person? He said, I'm the camera person. It was Adam Dusenberry, 12 years old. He was a scout, Boy Scout, Eagle Scout, actually. So, you know, I was a little reluctant because, you know, the idea was he was going to do the camera and I was going to talk and interview people and talk to the camera. Well, he did a great job. It was fantastic. Look at the footage, and he was perfect as a cameraman and got the shots. It was almost like he knew what I was saying and got all the shots the way I would have done it. And then edited it and got it all ready to go. So I was 12 years old. He was
Adam Dusenberry?
Adam Dusenberry.
Who was here?
It's right. And then I think this is where he was hired first, wasn't it? I forget where.
Gilbert Gottfried sat there.
Oh, yeah. Well, there you go.
You know what he said?
No.
A guy gets up in the middle of his own show. It's my show, right?
It's right.
If I got Gilbert Gottfried and I leave, he's got only Johnny Byers in the audience.
Yeah. Well, it puts your guest on the spot. I can see, you know.
No, because I had him reading his book. When I have authors, I have them read their book.
Oh, dear.
So he's reading the book. I want to get up and do something. You know what I want to do? You want to know what I want to do?
Yeah.
I want to get my Kleenex and wipe my eyes. I was laughing so hard.
Yeah.
I just didn't want to be on camera with my face streaming.
Right. Well, that's what I'm saying. When you got one shot, though, you can't help it. It's like, she probably, well, I guess you need a crew for that.
Great. It's visual radio.
It's got
character. Good
character.
You know, I think Joe LaRocca did this wonderful little promo for me.
Yeah.
Which is,
I do like that because it's
Joe LaRocca is very gifted, genius. He just left us. He's teaching film, I think, over at Harvard.
Really?
Something like that. Not at Harvard, but at Harvard. They have film classes. I met some film people over at Harvard.
But they have the Harvard film class course and the Harvard film archives.
So Joe's a very gifted man.
We actually got some, in the early days of BFEF, we worked with the Harvard Film Archives to do, we used to have, what was good about BFEF is the whole idea was not only have a place to get equipment, but also a place to learn how to use equipment, we teach, and we also, I thought one of the best things was, we always had screenings of video art, and you always got to meet the artist as well as see the work, and I always thought that was the best thing about BFEF. So we're trying to bring that to METV, where every year now we've done this thing called video shorts where young filmmakers and videographers show their work and then get to talk about it. And that's growing like crazy. Now people want us to do more than once a year. They want to do it twice a year. So I think we will.
You're going to have more space?
Well, that deal fell through, unfortunately,
going
next door. Yeah. But I think it's temporary. I think eventually they'll come around. The story about the ballpark, do you hear about that? There's supposedly a ballpark coming to Malden.
Yeah. Let's get a...
Oh, you make calls out, too?
Why not?
I don't know.
He might be at his nephew's baseball game.
Hey, Joe. How are you?
John, say hi to Ron Cox.
Hi, Ron. How are you?
I'm fine. How you doing?
Good.
John's one of our co-hosts. He does sports with us.
Oh, okay.
He is legendary on 98.5 and EEI for being John from Medford.
Oh, okay.
He runs for mayor against McGlynn.
Well, somebody's got to run against
him. John, is there a score tomorrow? What's your psychic score for Friday?
Oh, God, I don't even want to attempt to predict the score now because right now there's very much upheaval in this Red Sox organization. What happened yesterday, John Lester has basically forced, he said something to the media, and then he tweeted back that he wanted, he basically said he would welcome a trade.
Really?
Boston.
Wow.
And then he tweeted out he loves playing in Boston, he wants to remain playing for Boston. If he wants out, send him over to Seattle, where he's from, and I think that gets you Felix Hernandez.
That'd be nice.
It would take more than that, but I mean, just as a start, the big thing is that the Red Sox, I like Kyle Crawford, but the Red Sox have to find a way to get out from under that contract, because that contract is going to cost us Jacoby Ellsbury, because Jacoby Ellsbury is a free agent this year, and when Jacoby gets free agency, the Sox are not going to have enough to sign him, because they're already at the limit with this Crawford contract.
It was the revenge of Epstein.
Everyone says, even a friend of mine that I've talked to about many times, says basically what Epstein did by signing that contract is assured that Jacoby would leave, and Jacoby probably ends up next year in Chicago with Epstein.
No, we're going to keep him. Anyways, I wanted to touch base and say hi to you and have you say hi to Ron.
How are you?
Because we're talking access.
Talking access, right.
You know, I found, I don't know, did you like to talk a little bit of music. Did you hear about the latest music book that's out there, the Mick Jagger book?
I've heard of it, yes.
Evidently, Mick, there were a few situations that Mick has been involved in. He writes in his book on two situations. He was peeved at not being invited to the royal wedding because evidently he tried to pick up prince's girlfriend at a club, and he ended up hooking up with the sister, Pippa Middleton, and then he wanted to be knighted. And
well, you know, going after the sister-in-law, my God, that's not, you're not going to get knighted.
He got knighted, but the problem was the queen wouldn't do it. The prince had to do it, Prince Charles, and
then Mick hit on the prince.
Well, no, Mick didn't hit on the prince, but he called the queen something, which, let's just say, the Wicked Witch.
Okay, with a B. Johnny, thank you for calling, letting us call out to you.
Yeah.
Good one.
Mick Jagger just turned 70. Can you believe that?
He takes us in directions we don't want to go, yeah. But that's okay. Johnny's great.
Yeah. But I'm saying Mick Jagger just turned 70. Can you believe that?
He might be 71 or 72.
Yeah.
Because he might have shaved a couple of years off his age.
He might have, yeah. Well,
that's what I heard.
He probably used it up, I think.
I managed his producer, so...
Yeah, sure he used it up.
You know, it's the 50th anniversary of the Rolling Stones tour. Have you seen the
Stones?
And
the Beach Boys.
Oh, and the Beach Boys are doing well. What are the plans for Malden Axis? What's the vision for the future?
Well, as a matter of fact, we spent the last 2 years working on our strategic plan, our three-year strategic plan. So we're already into year one. And essentially, it was, you know, talk about expansion and try it, which we have and were successful. So now what we're going to do is kind of reassess the building itself we're in and upgrade that. And Studio B is downstairs. We want to bring it upstairs, so we're going to do that. We're going to kind of configure the rooms a little more efficiently. You know, now you don't need a big room for control room. I mean, I'm not sure how big your control room is now, but...
Dave made it big.
Is it big? Yeah.
It wasn't like this. Dave, that's Dave's vision in there.
Okay. I'd like to check it out.
And I give Dave 100% credit for...
Oh, but I'd like to check it out, because nowadays you don't need a big control room, but I'd be interested to see how we did it.
Because it was smaller. It was not designed well.
Yeah.
And Dave came in, and really he did a good job of changing the whole place around.
Yeah. Well, I like to look at it, because I we're trying to work on ours, and
you got to come in during the day, probably next week, and hang out with Dave.
Well, I'm going on vacation. My family does the annual reunion, so I'm going to Las Vegas. My brother lives out there, so...
Extended family?
Yeah, my sister, my other brother lives in Austin, Texas, is coming up, so my sister, my two brothers, and all the family, and some friends. Normally, we do Gloucester, we've done Hampton Beach. This year, Ricky said, you know, come out here this time. So he lives in Las Vegas, so I haven't been out in a while, so yeah, it'd be good.
That should be fun.
We're going to get a houseboat and go on Lake Mead. And, you know, really bring it back to life.
Shoot some Access.
That's right.
Access and Vegas. Do you take
I kind of want to bring the kids. I wasn't going to, but the more I do this trip, I really want to document it. So.
Well, you know the motto here, Visual Radios, T-E-F-T.
And what's that stand for?
Tape every fun thing.
Yeah. Well, it makes a lot of sense.
Fun.
Yeah. And I do tape a lot of stuff. And that's the trouble. You know, when you're not working, you still tape. And I do that, so.
I just have a tape in there from 2010, the toys.
Yeah.
Barbara Harris, how gentle is the rain. Right. So it's cute. And it was on my birthday 2 years ago at the Chevalier Theater.
Really?
And,
well, how is that theater? That's a great theater.
We're going to put shows in there. We're putting shows in there this September, October.
Because you've got a treasure here. I mean, you know, talk about Arlington has theirs.
We need a new mayor. Let me get on about the city council. This is amazing. Every week, they just...
Has this become a political show already?
They rail about the mayor every week. Yeah. Every week, they rail. And so, I went up there to talk about Channel 1, Comcast On Demand.
Yeah.
And I said, every one of you elected officials should be on demand. We only have the mayor there. So then they started saying, where's our Verizon? We're not on Verizon yet. The government channel isn't on Verizon yet.
Really?
And so they made a motion, 7-0. So I get things going.
Right.
I go up there and I'm meeting
the charge. You know, Malden Verizon piggybacks off the signal of Comcast. You believe that? And now we upgraded Comcast signal, so now they can't do that. So they got to figure out a way to deal with that. And so they actually came down today to work that out. Because Comcast is, there's no signal to piggyback off of now for them because we digitized it.
So Verizon has to be separate.
Right.
Now Verizon has contiguous channels. So in Malden, do you live in Malden?
Yeah, that's one thing Verizon does is they show other community media centers.
Yes.
I'm not sure what formula they use though. I don't know what the formula is because, yeah, sometimes Wakefield's on, sometimes it isn't, and then Stoneham's on. And
well, what they told us was we're getting your feed.
Oh, good. Good for you.
So we're getting Malden, Melrose, Wakefield, Stoneham, and Hudson.
Hudson? Why Hudson?
Hello? So Hudson picked up visual radio. Next week we'll be on in Hudson. They just picked us up. I mailed a package out tonight. That was really nice of them. Thank you, Hudson. We're back on in Wakefield. So we get Malden, Stoneham, Wakefield, and Hudson. Four stations.
Are you on in Salem?
I'm on in Salem.
All right, so hi, Salem.
I haven't mailed Patrick Kennedy the tape. Thank you.
So Patrick Kennedy started out as an intern when I was there.
I got to send Patrick.
Now he has my old job.
Wow, he does. That's. Thank you.
Or does he have Dave's old job? I'm not sure.
I have so many stations, getting them all out.
Yeah. I don't know how you do it, Joe. I'm starting to think about it because now I'm a nationally award-winning show. So
Peg Media.
I have to get it out.
Peg Media.
That's what I got to do.
And what's Peg the Media. Local thing of Peg Media? There's another one.
Mass Access? Mass Access.
I got to join Mass Access. Yes. I was over at Wilmington. Have you been there?
Yes.
And they were showing me because, I was up at CGY with one of the guys, 93.7.
Mm-hmm.
So he's over in Wilmington now. So he was showing me the Mass Access and the Peg Media. And I'm like, what am I making DVD copies for?
Yeah. Pretty soon we're going to be, doing it. We right now, when you edit a piece, it gets sent right to the computer server, the Mac server. So unless you master it out on DVD, we don't even need the DVD. We just go right into the server. And it's great. Now, do you have a server here?
We have a server. Now, our tape machine isn't working tonight or last week, so...
So you're ingesting the show as we speak?
We're ingesting as we speak.
Oh, that explains it. I could use the Tums right now.
in 3 minutes, Della Streeter will call in from Alaska.
Yeah.
You can stay if you want. It's just 5 minute talk about... Yeah.
No, I do have to go. I know I made a commitment to come, and I came in 45 minutes. Almost 45. Is it past 45 minutes? Yeah.
Yep.
But I've had a good time, Joe. I mean, you do a good show. And I think, people talk about content. It's not easy to get guests for those people who try to do a show. Getting guests is your biggest challenge outside of getting a crew. So you do a good show with getting good content.
I wanted to have you on. You're an important person in public access in Massachusetts. And, we're friends, but I'm honored that you came here because you have a lot to give to the community. And
well, thank you. I feel like I've been around for a long time. That's the only reason. I've just been around too long. I've seen too much is probably it. But you're right. Right now it's a challenging time because, right now Verizon is trying to get a new bill before the state legislature to get rid of the idea of having them have to negotiate with every city and town. It's easy for them to just negotiate with the state. And let the state give out the money. And we all know how good the state is at giving out money.
And we all know what would happen to Access TV.
It'd be gone. And in fact, there's a record to show that in states that have gone to statewide franchising, the number of Access centers has now lessened.
And in those states, do they cluster?
Some states do, yeah. Like it's regional, like even down the Cape, it's regional for Massachusetts. You've got three or four coming together.
Plymouth now wants to come together with what, Duxbury or something? There's some big...
Yeah, I think that's one of... They're looking at, getting the best out of you, saving the resources. So there is some of that going on. What's happening is the cable companies are dropping the deal. They used to run them themselves. So now they're just kind of dropping them in the communities, and some communities aren't ready to run them, and that's what happens. They don't get run the right way, and you get politics and trouble. So,
well, we're here to save Access. Burlington has a nice little disc, Save Access.
Yeah.
You got to
fight for it. This is a right, I think, for people to have a local place to give their point of view, to celebrate who they are, the diversity of ideas. That's what local Access is, and you've got to strengthen it. You've got to support it, and to me, it is the voice of democracy, really. And speaking of voices, who's this?
I bet it's Frank Delastrito. Hello?
Joe, Frank Delastrito. We ready to talk about movies?
Yeah, calling in from Alaska. Thank you, man.
I have to run.
All right, Ron.
Great to say hi. How's Alaska now?
Alaska is, I imagine it's always delightful, but if you're not used to the cold, this is the time to be here, because it's not all that bad.
All right. Well, have a good show. I'm actually with the first guest. I'm heading out. Nice to meet you, and good luck.
Thank you.
All right, Joe. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Ron.
Take care.
Give me the mic.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, Frank, what are we talking about? My beautiful laundrette?
We're talking about my favorite brunette.
Almost.
1947, starring Bob Hope and Dorothy Lamour, as well as Peter Lorre and Lon Chaney.
Oh, wow.
So you got an all-star cast. Like so many of the movies you get, this is the late 1940s when the movie business was going through an upheaval, partially because taste changed during the war, partially because of television, partially because the movie companies were losing suits and antitrust. Things were kind of topsy-turvy. So a lot of movies made then, for various reasons, fell into the public domain. The owners of the copyrights never renewed them, either by confusion or whatever, and they've gotten to the public domain, and this is one of them. And also, your pick of movies has attended an affection, I should say, for film noir, and this may be the first film noir comedy. I won't swear to that, but it's brazenly follows some of the formulas of some of the other ones, you know, for laughs instead of for atmosphere. But it's got a film noirish quality when it settles down a bit. But it's usually a madcap comedy.
Film noir comedy. I've not heard that yet.
Okay, well, it makes fun of it. It's a comedy based on the film noir style. So it is a film noirish. I should say it's a comedy following film noir. It hasn't got a film noirish feel, but it's a comedy parodying the film noir style.
Interesting.
And let's see. We showed this movie a few months ago. We had a good talk about it then. So let me concentrate on a couple of different elements. This is also an era when some people who were working pretty regularly in Hollywood were starting to have trouble finding work. And there's fewer movies being made. The new generation is coming in, so some of the older, more familiar faces are either stereotyped or just seen as familiar faces. And so Peter Lorre and Lon Chaney were very busy through the early 1940s, and things are going to slow down for them in the late 1940s. And a lot of the character actors who were so busy during the 30s and the war years have to start almost parodying their own stereotypes to keep busy. And that's certainly true in this movie. Lon Chaney is doing a blatant imitation of his first great role, which was Lenny in Of Mice and Men. And if you haven't seen him in Of Mice and Men, 1939 movie, be prepared to shed some tears, because that is a heart-wrenching performance. And it's a brilliant performance, and it deserved an Academy Award nomination, but it didn't get one, I think mainly because mentally challenged characters just didn't get nominations like that. There weren't that many.
They frightened the status quo, I would think.
Jay rips your heart out. I mean, this movie rips your heart out, and he's at the very center of it. And Peter Lorre was, of course, he seemed to be in every other Warner Brothers movie through the 40s, and things are starting to slow down for him, and he's starting to parody himself, and he'd spend a lot of the last decade of his life, which isn't quite 1947, he died in 1964, I believe, but most of the last decade or so of his life, he was making fun of his great role, so... You know, and in that sense, there's a certain sadness to it. But I will say, both Chaney and Lorre throw their hearts into this movie, so they're giving the best performance they can, and they do a good job. I think the last time we talked about this movie, I was throwing a lot of praise to a character actor named Charles Dingle, who plays a major role in this. But of course, he's not a known name, so he's way down on the cast list. But he's a very effective villain, as he always was. Let's see. But the one man who's not
left.
Excuse me.
30 seconds left.
30 seconds. One person who's not suffering at this time is Bob Hope, who's still riding high. He's still making Road 2 movies. He's about to make the first of his Pale Face movies. And my favorite brunette was a sequel to my favorite blonde, in a sense, and a prequel to my favorite spy, in a sense. All of them did good business for him. And I guess we're about out of time.
And we are. Frank, enjoy Alaska.
I'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Show. Bye.